the insights. I would like to start to let you know that this presentation is not a set of motivational quotes that we see from Instagram. These are practical tools that I have actually used in my journey to look for positions in market research area. So if you found out about our events via the WeChat group, if you can see here, it says in the sea of accounting, finance, and CS, you chose something that's mainstream as non-mainstream as market research, and you are now in a clueless position. I personally found it really hard to explain to people around me exactly what I'm doing. True story, the day after my convocation, my aunt asked me, so what is the area that you're going to look for a job in? Which area is that? I said, market research. So she said, okay, so when are you going to find a boyfriend? True story. So I...
So have you found a boyfriend yet?
MRA's first ever student job fair. Then I attended the MRA student job fair. Following that, I actually got my first interview with DIG, but unfortunately I was rejected back then because I didn't know much about what's happening in the industry. But I didn't give up, luckily. I continued to volunteer with MRA at their national conference in Quebec. That's where I got to speak to one of DIG's co-founders at the event. After the Quebec conference, I sent an email to follow up with the HR person at DIG, and I got my second interview, and I was accepted. So you might be wondering what happened between the two interviews. First of all, I gained more understanding of the industry by talking to more industry professionals. I actually realized what the core responsibility of a market research analyst during my first interview with my interaction with the HR person. I also developed a profile to better present myself in the second interview. So what happened at DIG? DIG has been expanding. They hire new management, so as a result, DIG is seeking for new support in the team. These are the three key factors that I think that maybe got accepted in my second interview. These are networking, follow-ups, and profile. So networking. I know that we're kind of overwhelmed by the idea of networking, just the idea of going out to talk to strangers and don't know what the result will turn out. It's quite scary. There are some steps that we can take to strategically plan our networking. For example, my biggest advice would be having a wingman or a wing lady. This could be somebody that know you, could be your peers, could be your friends that could support you during this conversation. The existence of this person will make you feel less scared in networking sessions. The second one, as you can remember from my experience, I have a lot of volunteering experience with MRA. So I thought volunteering could be actually a really good way to networking in different situations. For example, you're really likely to get an attendance list. Then you can take a step ahead to research on these people and get to know these attendees in advance. You are also an insider, so you know the small details of the conference, the timeline, the attendance list, for example, as I mentioned before. You can also use this as a conversation starter if you don't know what to talk about. This leads to my third one, which is to prepare an elevator pitch. This is an example of an elevator pitch I use during my job hunting. So I say, hi, my name is Cindy. I am a market research student looking for an internship in this area. That's why I'm volunteering here, to get to know more about the industry and what brought you. So it's an easy, it's a smooth conversation starter, especially when you're volunteering here. Last one is, if you still feel scared about networking, you can start with people that you already know. This could be your professor, your career counselors from school. I personally invited my professor to a coffee talk, and we talked through a lot of things, and she recommended books and articles or agency that I can go for. This could be really useful resources for us. I do want to take a look at the language issue. For me, English is not my first language, so when I was looking for a job, this is actually one of my concerns. I listed some questions that I asked myself before I was looking for a position. The first is, how well am I mastering the language? Am I really fluent on it? Or am I only able to deliver simple and basic points in my conversation? Or am I not having a lot of fancy vocabularies, but I'm really grateful to just talk whatever that's in my mind. So understand what your communication style is. The second one is, how important is language in this position that I'm applying to? Do I need to write a lot? Do I need to write full reports? Or do I only need to have bullet points or commentaries next to my graph in this PowerPoint? Or do I need to speak a lot? Do I need to do full presentation to my clients? Or I'm more of a back-end supportive role at the beginning? And the last one is, do I have other strength to offset this challenge? For example, if I am really good at SPSS, or if I'm really good at coding, then the challenge of language could be offset by these skills that we have. The last one is, our knowledge of Chinese is also a strength in this area. The study of multicultural projects are actually been growing. A lot of larger companies are focusing on this area. I can tell you from my experience, because I work with Robin, we have a lot of multicultural projects. Sometimes when a Chinese questionnaire comes in, or a respondent sending some comments in, I can just read them. I don't need to bother to go after the translator and then wait for the translator to get back to me. This is really efficient from my end. So my language is also a strength for me. So the second key factor is follow-ups. I'm not sure if everybody is familiar with the idea of follow-up. So this will be after you interact with this person at a meeting or at an event, after you left the event, you send an email. Email is one of the forms that you can follow up. You send an email to remind the person of you and the conversation that you have. I break the idea of follow-ups into three areas. So general networking, post-interview follow-ups, and reminders. The first type is general networking. This is really important to tailor your follow-ups towards your respondents only. One of the paragraphs that I've written in my follow-up email is like, we talked about this issue in our conversation, and I refer to this article. I feel like you might be interested in reading it. This is the link. So it's smooth, it reminds me, it reminds that person of the conversation. The second one is post-interview follow-up. This is known as the thank you letter. So you want to appreciate employer's time. You want to emphasize how you fit this, you fit the job that you're applying for. And you also add in some important things or traits that you think are contributing to your profile. Big reminder, double check spelling name of the hiring manager. I'm pretty sure you use the same thing if you letter to all the jobs that you apply. This is the only way that you customize your thank you letter. I remember 4 or 5 years ago when I attended the full open campus day at Shule, the admission officer gave us a presentation on how people use the same university application for all the business school they acquired. So actually she received Dear Officer at Brown, Dear Officer at Queen's College. I mean, if you want to apply there, at least get the name correct, right? That's a really basic manner, and it shows that your message is well prepared. Last one is reminders. This will serve a purpose to remind HR of you and and make yourself known what's happening inside of the organization. If you remember from my experience, that's how I got the message of, hey, Dave is actually hiring. That used to be interesting us. So what we do is we appreciate that HR spent time with you in your last interaction and you share what's going on in your life. The events that you're sharing, it would be the best if it is related to the industry. So for example, what I wrote in my follow-up email to HR at Dig is, I attended the co-founder's presentation at MRA event, and I comment on his humorous presenting style. So that's related to what's happening with the organization. The third point is profile. On the side, I offer kind of a consulting session for high school students to apply for the university, so I help them prepare their university application profile. I found that through this experience, I found a lot of the high school students, they have done amazing things and have great achievements in their lives, but they don't have the storytelling ability to deliver the story and the experience to present it in a more attractive way. You must have heard of the word storytelling in this industry. So what is a profile? I think it's a list of things that you've done. This could be your past working experience. This could be your volunteering experience. It can also include 1 to 2 projects that you've done in the past and make you really feel proud about yourself. All this can go on your LinkedIn. LinkedIn is a really important outlet for you to present yourself. It's also for people who doesn't necessarily have a paper copy or your resume to just go online and see your profile. So make sure you have a presentable profile. The last one is don't overdo soft skills. I know nowadays people emphasize on teamwork, like emotional intelligence, and you can probably come up with another 10 items on the list. But you can't prove these soft skills until you use example to prove them. So using those so-called soft skill terms in the objective line of your resume, it just make you the same as all the other applicants, because we all use the same thing. Instead, we can use some skills that you actually know, like software skills. Are you really good at Excel? Are you really good at VBA or SPSS? Or do I know coding? Those things are more eye-catching than the so-called soft skills. So moving on to the last session, these are some resources that we can utilize as market researchers or as recent graduates to look for a position. The first one is obviously MRA. Again, if you remember from my experience, a lot of my volunteering opportunities are offered by MRA. I supported with their national conference in Quebec. I also helped them with some projects. This will be a great chance to get to know people in the industry and get to know exactly what's going on, what's the trend in the industry. The second one is less of a authority. There is meetup.com. They have a lot of groups out there on the website. One of the groups that I've been involved in is Women in Data Analytics. From my experience, experience attending these events, some of the event participants will share internal postings inside when these events are happening. So it's a great chance for you to firstly get to know people mostly of our same age, and also to know these internal postings that are not available outside of the organization. The third one is Coursera.com. This is an online platform that allows you to take courses offered by famous universities like Stanford or University of Pennsylvania. You can take numerous courses there. I think they have some specialization that are tailored towards market research or data analytics. Very interesting. One thing good about Coursera.com is when you take courses or specialization on this website, if you pay certain amount of money, you can have the certificate post on your LinkedIn. I think they have some relationship. Coursera has some relationship with LinkedIn, so you can show the certificates on the LinkedIn profile as well. Last one is your alumni, your career center, and your professors. These are people that you already may have interacted with. They have a lot of resources that we can utilize. I think this is the last. I said this is going to be a long presentation. So, book recommendation. This book is called Networking for People Who Hate Networking. A Field Guide for Introverts, the Overwhelmed, and the Underconnected. Don't read by the name of the book, but this is one of the books that keep me accompanied during my process of networking and look for a position, just go out there. This is a really handy tool. The style of the book is really funny and it's resourceful. It's a resourceful guidebook. As a field guide, the author maps out the steps that we can take to strategically design our networking pathways. Why is that? This book kind of breaks the stereotype of networking and it provides a really handy step-by-step tools. It has some worksheets that you can fill to evaluate your performance in networking events to make you feel less stressful and less overwhelmed by the idea of networking in general. Then special thanks to Robin and Georgia to help me offer a lot of great advice for my presentation, and that's it. That wraps up my presentation.